we shall defend our island. And with the British Empire around us, we shall fight on, unconquerable, until the curse of Hitler is lifted from the brows of men.
We will have no truce or parley with you or the grisly gang who work your wicked will. You do your worst, and we will do our best. When I warned them that Britain would fight on alone, whatever they did, their generals told their prime minister and his divided cabinet, in 3 weeks, England will have her neck wrung like a chicken. Some chicken. Some neck. Advance, Britannia. Long live the cause of freedom. God save the king.
Today I'm hoping to have a conversation all about Sir Winston Churchill, and I'm joined by Professor Edward the Jolly Heretic Dutton. How are you, sir?
Hello. Yes, I'm okay. Yes.
Okay. Great. Well, you know a great deal about. You're published on Churchill, so I mean, if that's not an expert, I don't know what is.
This book here, this one here. Yes. And I also did an article in the Cumbria Encyclopedia on his butler.
Right. Yes, I have heard you mention that before. So it's obviously Churchill is obviously a really big figure, a complicated figure. There's some people in history, I think it's fair to say, it's sort of what you see is what you get. They're not too deep. There's not that many levels to them. Yeah, I'm thinking of further back in history, of course, the more it's a problem. But you know, someone like Genghis Khan is sort of almost two dimensional. Whereas someone like Churchill is a complicated figure. Wouldn't you agree? I mean, you can find quotes where he contradicts himself, and you know, he changed parties throughout his life. He had a very complicated life, absolutely filled with events. So he's a very difficult figure, do you think? Or
yes, I think that, I mean, a lot of what we talk about in contemporary culture at the moment, and a lot of what you talk about on the Lotus Eaters and what I talk about on my channel, is the repression at the hands of the left. Is that there are certain left-wing taboos that we that are kind of religious dogmas, in a sense, that we can't break and we can't question. If we do, we get cancelled or we get deplatformed or whatever it happens to be. And that's a serious problem at the moment. But there are still some, I suppose you might call them right-wing taboos, areas that are dogmas of the right that is so ingrained that even in our highly liberal runaway individualism, you know, transsexual society, we can't question those. And one of those is Churchill, because he is the founder of the modern state. He is the greatest Briton. He is the embodiment of a certain kind of boomer patriotism. And so to question him and to question what he was like undermines that. But the reality is that he was an incredibly complicated character indeed. And I would say, actually, not a very pleasant character, not a very nice character at all. Mm. And that makes sense, because in general, the kind of people that are charismatic leaders that come and lead a country at a time of war and crisis. And that is, I mean, you could argue that's a good thing. You could argue, yeah, he led the country through the war. Do tend to be highly intelligent people with certain kinds of psychopathic traits, and also certain kinds of mental instabilities like depression and things like that. And that was certainly true of Churchill. But I think the problem is that, yes, he led us through a war, but I would argue, and I argue it in my book, Churchill's Headmaster, The Sadist State of the British Empire, he also caused that war. So you're dealing with a person, as far as I can see, who was Machiavellian, who was a narcissist, who was thoroughly dishonest, who was quite sadistic, who was extremely mentally unstable and a depressive, who was a shameless self-promoter, who was an alcoholic, who was a glutton, who was a warmonger, who was a killer, and who basically, one could argue, through putting us through this completely unnecessary war, sped up the collapse of the British Empire and of Britain. So I think it's fair to say that I'm not a fan. And it's his headmaster, Herbert Snaid Kinnersley, and that's what fascinated me. To the extent that people have heard of his prep school headmaster, George Ascot, Herbert Snaid Kinnersley, he's a disgusting, sick, perverted sadist who took sexual pleasure in beating boys on their bare buttocks until they excreted, and then took further sexual pleasure in cleaning the excrement off the walls. That is what we are supposed to believe if we believe these hagiographies. This is a book called Anna Seba, who says this, but that's what we're supposed to believe. And I looked, I thought, well, can it be that extreme? Can that be true? And the fact that I then started to read things that made me doubt the Churchill myth made me think, well, maybe the Snake Kinnersley, you know, that he's Satan, is something that's been kind of put about by Churchill and his supporters and exaggerated over the years. And that's exactly what I found. Snake Kinnersley is nowhere near as appalling as he's understood to be. And a lot of the, I tracked down the grandchildren of people that had been, whom he taught at school, and they thought he was great. So it was Churchill that didn't think he was great, because Churchill was an appalling little child. And psychopathology, one of the markers of psychopathology is antisocial behaviour as a child, which he was certainly had. So, yes, I think he's much more complicated and much and not as positive as is generally painted to be the case.
Right, yeah, you talk about that, the taboos. Of course, you're talking about the fact that sort of the baseline for a lot of people, I think, in the popular consciousness for people is that, that Churchill is just simply a great figure, a hero. He saved us from Mr. Hitler. And that's sort of the base, like, you know, like the Momolum thing of the best, the greatest Britain of all time sort of thing. If that's some sort, if people are sort of don't know their history that well, that might be sort of the baseline they're brought up with. And then you don't believe so?
Why did you mention Momolum? Is it because he's short, fat and bald?
Was it not Momolum who was voted for the
Oh, I see. I thought you were saying that he was like Momolum.
Oh, no. When he was voted the greatest Britain of all time.
Oh, she was his advocate.
I think so, yeah. Was that not the case?
Oh, right, I don't know.
Oh, well, anyway. But anyway, if that's sort of the baseline for some people, and then, as you say, like when you read into it more and more, you realise that it's far much more complicated than that, if not the opposite in most cases. But you did mention, you know, there are still some redeeming features, like, for example, a few times during the war where you sort of needed perhaps an implacable leader, where would you agree that there's even some moments?
Yeah, there is some evidence. It's but there's a French philosopher called Henri Nouwen, and he has this concept of the wounded healer. And the idea is that a lot of people who are charismatic leaders, the charismatic leader is defined by Max Weber as someone who has certain qualities whereby he is able to inspire people and, in essence, make a cold world feel warm again. And sort of bring people up and make them certain that everything's going to be okay. He has this kind of intoxicating positive power. And it's been found that a lot of people that have that are depressives. And it's because they are depressives that they have to... one way of dealing with depression and chronic negative feelings, which is what Churchill definitely had. He was a depressive, and he talked about wanting to kill himself, and he talked about black dog, which was his word, his term for his depression, and all of this sort of thing. One of the ways that you can deal with that is by creating a false self. It's kind of like borderline personality disorder or narcissism, indeed. You create a false self as a way of coping with all these negative feelings. You tell yourself, I'm wonderful, I'm brilliant, I'm fantastic, you know. And this gives you an aura of confidence, and this allows you, in a sense, to cure that depression in others. So you can, because you're so confident and whatever, and they will be hypnotized by your magnetic confidence and positiveness. And I think that that's something that was true of Churchill, you know, in the worst all areas of war. You know, we will fight them on the France, we shall fight on the landing ground, you know, all this sort of thing. And I think that's certainly true of him. That was positive. There are positives. He was clearly an excellent writer. He was a very, very good writer. I'm not saying he was a truthful writer. In fact, I've gone through his book, My Early Life, and I found various things in it that are just plain wrong. Right. That are lies. For example, he made out that it was General Botha that arrested him when he was taken prisoner in South Africa, and that's simply not true. And so all I can conclude is that he just made that up to make it a better story, or that he was so fascinated by status and power that he kind of convinced himself it had been the case when in reality it wasn't the case. Mm. So there were things like that, but he was an excellent writer, excellent speaker, charismatic, clearly very witty and funny and all that sort of thing. And obviously there was something sort of charming and childlike and likeable about him. I mean, I was watching a French series recently about Charles de Gaulle. A lot of countries, you know that thing, The Crown on Netflix? It's been so successful that a lot of countries have tried to do their own version of it. So Norway has done its own version of it about Princess Maud. Martha, whatever her name was, I forget, but the one that had an affair with Roosevelt. And then France has done one about de Gaulle. And there's a scene in it where Churchill is talking to de Gaulle in French about his plans. De Gaulle rejects the plans and Churchill completely loses his temper and just goes, "Bugger, bugger, bugger, up your bum." And Anthony Eden goes, "Winston, really?" And you can and you can completely imagine that, that there's something of the Boris about him, I suppose, which is why I think that people like Boris and forgive Boris. And Boris kind of identifies with Churchill. That's why he's written this very bad book about Churchill called The Churchill Factor, in which I've found numerous errors. It's just a hagiography, really. But Boris is like that, the kind of person that has this, is charismatic and inspiring and has this sort of childlike element to them, which people really like and trust. So that was what, but the negative, it's a brilliant tactic. I think it's a tactic that Churchill and Boris both use, which is that really we're talking about Machiavellian narcissistic people, but they're so good at it that they're able to come across as kind of childlike and slightly incompetent. And this makes them all the more kind of alluring to the public.
Right, but you suggest that maybe that's the flip side of the coin of psychopathy on some level.
Well, it's an element of psychopathy. It's not even the flip side. One of the 12 markers of psychopathy is a glib charm, a superficial charm. Right. So if we think, what kind of ecology is a psychopath evolved to? It's the extreme, unstable, dangerous ecology where you live fast, die young, and you could be killed at any minute, and you're entirely out for yourself. That means that there's no point making strong social bonds with people because those social bonds might never be reciprocated. So all you have to do is manipulate people. The essence of your life is to manipulate people in order to survive. And so anything that would help you do that should be part of a psychopathic personality. So what you have is they have low empathy. They don't care about the feelings of others. I mean, this is why Churchill was happy to, unnecessarily destroy Dresden.
Callow, doesn't he?
Callous. vengeance, or to unnecessarily, in my view, prosecute an unnecessary war when the Germans were making overtures for peace. So, and what he did in India as well, and his Gallipoli as well. Let's go back to that. The number of people that were unnecessarily killed when he was First Lord of the Treasury, First Lord of the Admiralty during World War One. It was absolutely extraordinary. And taking incredible risks with other people's safety and with his own safety. If you look at his early childhood, the risks he took, at one time he was playing chase or something with some friends. He was 18 years old. He jumped over a wall and he was unconscious for quite a considerable period of time, knocked himself out. He took considerable risks with his own safety as well as those of other people's. Mm. And that's a mark of a psychopath. But also being cognitively empathetic, that is that you know what other people think, but you're not effectively empathetic. You don't care, but you know. And you're like a cat rather than a dog. And those things all kind of come together in the psychopathic personality. And I think he was certainly a subclinical psychopath. And I think I'm right in saying, was he diagnosed as that by Felix Post? I can't remember, but I think he would certainly be what you call a subclinical, because a psychopath normally can't get to high positions of power in society because they're too lazy, they have too poor impulse control. A part of getting to a high social status in a complex society is that you have to have impulse control. You have to have some sort of conception of future, which you don't need in a highly unstable ecology. There is no future. You can be wiped out at any minute. But a subclinical psychopath, someone that has, let's say, 7 out of 12 of the Checkley psychopathic list, those kinds of people get very far. They are 50% of CEOs of major American companies, psychopaths. Mm-hmm. And they're very highly represented among politicians. And I think he certainly was one.
Because to be a psychopath doesn't mean you're Ted Bundy. It doesn't mean you go around butchering people and you can't help.
No, he would be a psychopath. A pure psychopath, but with very high intelligence.
Right.
So he had very high
IQ. Ted Bundy.
Yeah. So he was able to do okay because he had such fantastically high IQ, plus being a full psychopath. I think with Churchill, he had probably an IQ of 130, something like that, you know, normal range, high intelligence, but subclinical psychopathic traits.
So you did say quite a few things there that I thought were great and I'd love to talk about, but we can't do everything. But one of the things you said, he's a great writer, I absolutely agree. I love his history. The River War was very well written, I thought. Extremely well written. I don't know if you read that one, but it was great. You mentioned something else where you mentioned taking risks with his own life. No, absolutely. He was in the Lancers, wasn't he? He was at Omdurman in a charge, one of the last cavalry charges of the British Army, and killed people.
He made a point
personally.
Exactly. He was in one of the last cavalry charges of the British Army. And then when that was over, he always wanted to get to places of risk. So that he went as a journalist embedded with the British Army in South Africa, completely unnecessarily, just because he liked being in these dangerous places. So he's no longer a soldier by this stage. He was a journalist. And he was embedded with the British Army in South Africa. And it was at that point then that I believe I'm right in saying he kind of rejoined the army informally or something, and or so he said, and led the capture of Kimberley or some such Boer town. I forget which it was. So that was, he liked situations of danger. He liked the thrill of it. And in that sense, it's clearly a positive thing. He's the kind of person who, if you were in a really dangerous situation, you'd want someone like that. And he wouldn't be a hypocrite about it. He wouldn't be having other people take risks on his behalf. He'd be leading you into it and you know, leading the men. And indeed, in World War One itself, he left the cabinet and he went to the front.
I was going to ask you about that. Yeah, yeah. On the Western Front, sorry. Please go on. Sorry.
That's right. Well, that's right. That's another example of that. This is a person who has got balls. I say what you like about him. He's got balls. But I think part of that is that if you are a subclinical psychopath or whatever, then you are evolved to a situation of danger. That is your evolutionary niche, a situation of danger. You thrive in those situations. And if you are not in those situations, you'll try and create them. And that's what he did. As I say in the book, I don't think World War II was really necessary from a British perspective. What was going on with World War II? You have this, you have Poland, which is a very unpleasant nationalist dictatorship, which is very nasty to its German minority. You have the Czech Republic, which is a very unpleasant nationalist dictatorship, which is very nasty to anybody that's not Czech. And the Czechs weren't even a majority in Czechoslovakia. They were just the largest minority. And then you have Germany, which is a very nasty dictatorship, which is very unpleasant to the Jews and to the other minorities that it has. It's not really our problem as the British. It's nothing to do with us. The idea that we went in there to save some democracy, Poland, well, that's absolute rubbish. Mm. Poland was a military dictatorship, clearly. So that's nonsense. And so why did we go in there for? Oh, to stop the Holocaust. Well, there was no Holocaust at that time. The Holocaust, they wanted to get rid of Jews. They wanted to get Jews out of Germany because for whatever reason, for various reasons, they regarded them as a problem to the functioning of the German Reich. But they had ideas about putting them in Madagascar and goodness knows where. They didn't want to kill them. That ended up being a solution in a particular set of circumstances where they had all these Jewish people in Eastern Europe that were under their charge and they were fighting on the Eastern Front against Russia by that stage and on the Western Front against us. And so they had to deal with this situation. And that was what the final solution ended up being. Between the wars, I mean, that's the thing that's fascinating about it. This is a guy who, being a psychopath, being a narcissist, he had nowhere near enough money. There's a book about this called No More Champagne. He had nowhere near enough money to fund his extremely lavish lifestyle. He had, remember, in those days, members of Parliament weren't paid very much. It was almost like a nominal fee. And he had to maintain Chartwell. I don't know if you've been there, but it's this massive stately home. He had to maintain his lavish lifestyle, his drinking, his tobacco, his food, his various other interests and whatever. And he just didn't have enough money. And then when he was out of the cabinet, which he was by the end of the 1920s, he was no longer in the cabinet. He had to make money desperately. How do you make money? Well, one thing he started doing was writing. So why do you publish a memoir? Why do you publish an autobiography? Well, these days you do it to promote, you get people like, they're about my age, they're about 40. that are comedians that do it to sort of promote their career or get it ghostwritten, or you do it because you're a politician and you're old and you want settled scores or whatever, or you do it because you just need the bloody money, basically. You know you're famous and you cash in on it. And that's what he did. He was 55 and he wrote this autobiography, this My Early Life, and various other things. But it still wasn't enough money. And so he got involved with a group called The Focus. And The Focus were a various interest groups, trade unionists, Jews, whatever, that wanted a war, basically. They wanted there to be a war with Nazi Germany for ideological reasons. And they funded him as long as he would prosecute the case for war. One could argue it was kind of like a proto cash for questions. But it's probably more subtle than that. And so he prosecuted with all his oratorical skill the case for war in the context of a country that was very much against going to war, that didn't want to go to war. I mean, we were devastated by World War I. 8% of men that went out were killed. 12% of officers that went out were killed. Men were blinded. Men were maimed. Men were rendered impotent. And this was appalling. People did not want another war. My grandmother told me that when Chamberlain announced on the radio that we'd gone to war, her mother started crying because she knew that her sons would have to go out and fight and possibly be killed, and that she'd had siblings that had been killed in the first war. And so we were very much against the war, and it was Churchill that prosecuted the case for it, even though at the time he wasn't Prime Minister. And then eventually with the fiasco of Dunkirk. But let's look at that fiasco of Dunkirk. One way of interpreting the fiasco of Dunkirk is that the Germans kind of allowed us to escape because they wanted to sue for an honourable peace. And they didn't want to therefore annihilate the British or humiliate the British, because then they thought, well, there'll be no way we can sue for peace in that context. There were many instances of the Nazis trying to sue for peace once Churchill became Prime Minister, and this being rejected. And then eventually, when they were bombing military factories in Rotherhithe, and a stray bomb fell on some houses in Rotherhithe, and Churchill used this as an excuse to go for all-out war, to smash the living daylights out of Germany. And they even after that tried to sue for peace, and no good. And then some people have argued, I mean, it's one of those things that's a conspiracy theory, and I accept that, but some people have argued that Hess became a madman because his mission failed, but that before his mission failed, he may well have been sent to do it by the Nazi high command, because it would have been so incredibly difficult to do that, and how else could he have managed to do it? But who knows? But I certainly think that there was no... We could have sued for peace and stopped all the slaughter. And you can't possibly argue, well, if we'd done that, there wouldn't be as many Jews or whatever, because that came later due to specific sets of circumstances. Mm. So that's no argument. And the other argument is, how can we allow this to happen? How could we not get involved with these people on our doorstep? How could we be neutral? But Ireland managed to be neutral. Hmm. Well, neutral to the extent that it kept the lights on to direct the Nazi bombers in our direction. Sweden managed to be neutral. Various other countries managed. Spain managed to be neutral. So I mean, that's not really an argument. It's just a kind of lack of creative thinking. Mm. So I think that's the we didn't need to go into that war, and we didn't need to stay in it once we were in it. And Churchill made sure that we went into it, and then made damn sure that we stayed in it. And then he was absolutely determined that the Germans would be annihilated, smashed. Mm. But the result was that we were smashed. We were economically smashed, and we were the poor, sick man of Europe, while West Germany was making all the cars. So, I mean, I don't think it was, in retrospect, I mean, I guess I'm about your kind of age, and when I was a kid, you know, all I'd hear about from my granddad was the bloody war, you know, the war. But even he wasn't a fan of Churchill. He took the view, this is some aristocrat that sent me to fight. I didn't want to fight. But you had to, or you'd go to prison.
Yeah. Yeah, again, you've said so many, touched on so many things there I'd like to expand upon. But one of them, I suppose, just in broadly speaking, World War II. You know, on one end of the spectrum, you could say he's simply a hero that saved us from Mr. Hitler. On the other end of the spectrum, I've heard it characterised like this, I wonder what you think, that he essentially spent the British Empire in order that Stalin could control Eastern Europe. I mean,
what I think so first of all, I mean, Hitler set out clearly. So if we believe in what's called the philosophy of testimony, so if someone's, that's the idea that you should take something at face value unless you've good reason to think otherwise. And if we believe in the philosophy of testimony, Hitler set out in Mein Kampf when he was in his 30s, what he wanted to do, which was to take back the areas of Germany which had been taken by World War One and to expand into the East. That's what he said he wanted to do. And that's what he did. And he was very clear that he did not have any intention of invading Britain. He was very impressed by the British in World War One. He saw the British as brother Aryan nations, you know. And as far as he was concerned, he had no problem with them. They could have the British Empire, do what they like.
He did see the Bolsheviks as implacable enemies, though, did he not?
Well, yeah, he thought, because they were communists, and also they were Slavs. So they, as far as he was concerned, were a sort of subsection of the Europeans. And so as long as he could have a free hand in the East, that was what. Now, yeah, you could argue that in that context, you'd basically be giving Germany a great deal of power, and that all countries around them, like the Netherlands and indeed Britain, would have to live kind of in fear. And it would be a bit like Finlandization, where the Finns had to kind of kowtow to the Soviet Union to avoid being invaded by them or something like that. You know, you could argue that. But I suppose you could argue from another perspective that Britain was fairly dominant in Europe and had a great deal of power and so forth. And other countries had to be scared of Britain. So I don't know how well that... That argument follows. But as for your argument about what he did to the British Empire, then yeah, I agree. He completely, I think he sped up the decline of the British Empire. What that did was it put all of our resources or everything into the British Empire, into the war. And the result was we were bankrupt. We couldn't cope with the British Empire. And we had to dispense with the British Empire, often on quite unpleasant terms, on terms that weren't in our interests, or in the interest of the people whom we subjugated, such that they ended up in the hands of extremely unpleasant dictators, people like the Mau Mau, people like Robert Mugabe, and so on.
Indian politician.
And what I argue in the book is that at St. George's Ascot, where the idea is, oh, he was very, very badly behaved, and he was therefore being birched to the point that, and then they found his wounds, and they were so horrific that they withdrew him from the school, and then he went to the school run by two women, and there he almost died of pneumonia, and then he went to Harrow, and then he once he left Harrow and went to Sandhurst, he went back to the school with the intention of beating up the former headmaster, and he found the former headmaster had died. That story, by the way, I've traced that story. That last one comes from Churchill. This is all rubbish. What happened at that school is that he was beaten. That's true. But people were beaten regularly at prep schools at that time. Mm. So that's no argument. I found many instances that they were beaten more severely at other prep schools than at that prep school. Although nevertheless, that headmaster was relatively severe, it is true, even by the standards of the time. He would have beaten Churchill, fine. But the idea that he was withdrawn from the school because of the beatings, that's rubbish. That's something that's been made up later. No, he was withdrawn from the school because he had pneumonia, because he had some... he was born prematurely, 2 months prematurely, Churchill, which, by the way, also correlates with charisma. I've recently done a book on this called Sent Before Their Time, Genius, Charisma, and Being Born Prematurely. And I found that people that are born prematurely, severely prematurely, like 2 months, are statistically massively overrepresented among scientific geniuses, and they're very represented among charismatic figures and among religious figures. Buddha was born 3 months early, Moses was born 3 months early, Muhammad was born early, blah, 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 blah. And it's because of the brain damage it causes what's associated with charisma, which is depression, autism, ADHD, outlier intelligence. So it seems to be causal. Anyway, they have weak lungs. So Churchill had pneumonia, and that's why he was withdrawn from the school and sent to the school in Brighton. And Brighton was also where the family doctor lived. So it had nothing to do with the beatings. And then they said, oh, the beatings resulted in, it was found out by the parents and the school eventually closed down. That's not true. The headmaster of that school died aged 38 in 1886. and the school carried on under his deputy headmaster. And it was the deputy headmaster that was bad. It wasn't him. It wasn't Stake Kinnersley as much. It was the deputy headmaster that used to electrocute naughty pupils and eventually had to leave a subsequent school in Winchester, as far as I can work out, for buggering a pupil. So he was the not Snake Kinnersley. And then this idea that that the school closed because of the beatings, that's rubbish. And then this idea that he went back to beat him up, well, that's clearly something he must have made up, because he must have known the headmaster was dead. It was announced in the newspapers and everything. So and he would. So I don't. I'm not having that. So I think that you've just got this mythology. But what was happening in the school reports, what you see, is that when he starts at St. George Ascot, he's very badly behaved, and by the time he's withdrawn, he's very well behaved. So whatever it is this school is doing, it's working. It's making him better behaved. It's molding him into a non-psychopath, into a sort of a selfless person, you know. And then at that point, he's withdrawn from the school, some wishy-washy school of women and whatever, and then history. Now, it's true that the heritability of these kinds of traits, psychopathology, is very high, 0.8 or something. But it's certainly food for thought that it could have been that if he'd carried on at St. George's Ascot, maybe the devil would have been beaten out of him to an extent that he wouldn't have ended up being prime minister and wrecking the empire. And as I write in the book, never in the history of human civilization has so much rested. I wrote about grooming gangs and whatever, and I said, and it could all be traced back to one former pupil of his whom he simply hadn't quite had enough time to tame. Never in the history of human civilization has so much rested on what one headmaster did or didn't do to one boy's ass. I think that he did bring forward the decline of the empire.
Very, very interesting. I do think if you're trying to look at a historical figure, certainly a complex one, looking at their childhood is absolutely key. So, of course, no different with Winston Churchill. So it's a great stuff you've done there, looking into it. Again, you've mentioned five or six or seven different things I'd love to pick your brain about. But just to say about, again, the psychopathy thing, where he was... Well, potentially anyway, when World War One broke out, there are anecdotes that he was extremely happy. He was sort of over the moon by it. And of course, the story is all about World War Two, that he was sort of over the moon that they started bombing our cities and things, because yes, it meant that he now had political capital to do really what he wanted. And it does strike me. What do you think about this? It does strike me that in the memoirs and different biographies, he does seem to have, you said something very similar, and he wanted to absolutely annihilate Germany and Germans. He wanted to actually just punish innocent people.
He saw the Germans as absolutely as an enemy that needed to be destroyed. And this is a sort of psychopathic way of thinking. It's also consistent with what's called splitting. So... let's say that this pact diagnosis that Churchill was narcissistic or had narcissistic traits was correct. Then one of the things that these people, narcissism is kind of a form of borderline personality disorder, which is where you have these deep feelings of insecurity and you deal with it by creating a false self, but it's an unstable self, so you don't really feel it. And so therefore, every so often you have a breakdown and you create a new personality. So you notice that in extreme cases, you'll get the person that they're always into something to an extreme degree. You know, first they're an extreme communist, then they're an extreme nationalist, then they're an extreme trad Catholic, then they're an extreme vegan to the extent that they don't get enough nutrients and their hair falls out, you know, that these kinds of people. Well, Churchill wasn't like that, but I think that Churchill did present, I think, a false self to the world of this narcissistic, utterly confident sort of individual. I think that what you would expect someone like that to be like in borderline personality is to split. One of the ways that they are high in neuroticism, they're high in mental instability, high in anxiety, and one of the ways that you cope with that is by creating a world which makes absolute perfect sense. And another way that you cope with it is by creating a world in which you are morally superior to other people, so you feel better. And whoever is challenging you and making you doubt your own brilliance and therefore potentially dragging you towards the hollow, unstable, self, the unstable, abyss, the dark abyss at the heart of you, is evil. And so that's what you'd expect him to do, to engage in splitting. And so he would regard the Germans as just utterly, utterly evil, and himself as utterly, utterly morally superior. And if you read his war memoirs, the Second World War memoirs, all the time, it's, I'm right, I'm brilliant, everyone else is stupid, why didn't they listen to me? So he's obviously got this kind of superiority complex. And that would also fit with this fast life history strategy that I mentioned earlier, this adaptation to an unstable yet easy ecology, which is the essence of being a psychopath, which is what a psychopath is adapted to. So you have to be able to act with lethal force against potential enemies at any given moment to survive in an unstable ecology like that. Well, you're more likely to be able to act with lethal force against them if you regard them as implacably evil and wicked and have a strong desire to just destroy them. And therefore you will, and there'll be no negotiation. And I think that's therefore characteristic of his broader psychopathic personality.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, absolutely. That's very interesting, the splitting thing. I mean, because he did, it seemed to explicitly say about Germans and Germany, not just the Nazi government. He wanted to, you know, like Dresden was in like February 45 or something, and the war's over in April. There are already armies in Germany, or nearly in France.
Oh, yeah, certainly. Yeah.
So,
I mean,
that was completely unnecessary, utterly unnecessary.
It wasn't just Churchill, it was Bomber Harris as well.
Sure, okay, sure.
But basically, yeah, they took the view that they just need to be beaten into absolute submission. And what they did to Coventry was awful, and it, so you could argue it was kind of revenge for that. But it was an unnecessary degree of carnage. Mm. The idea that just totally carpet bombed, totally wipe out this city, and to literally try and kill people, to try and kill civilians. The idea originally is that you bomb military targets. Even Coventry was relatively close to some sort of military target, as I understand it. And the East End, of course, there was all kinds of factories and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But there was no reason to bomb Dresden other than just to destroy the morale of the German people.
And Hamburg got a drubbing, didn't it, Hamburg? And Berlin, of course, was razed, essentially. But, I mean, you say about Coventry, but, you know, two wrongs don't make a right. And it's easy to say in hindsight, but some of them, like Dresden, so close to the end of the war, it's impossible for me to find a justification that works.
And also, when we consider that we'd cracked their code, so we'd cracked Enigma, so we knew what they were doing, we knew what they were going to do. So eventually we were going to win the war. And the idea with Enigma was to engage in just enough bombing, just enough whatever, just enough military activity that we have the upper hand, but not enough that they realise that we know their code and thus change their code. I mean, that would have been the plan. Mm. And so you would have them logically and coldly saying, right, well, we know that a load of our men are going to get killed here, but we'll let them get killed, because if we don't, then we could they could realize that we've cracked the code. But here we can afford to allow to be at the place where they don't expect us to be, you know. Mm-hmm. and thus triumph over them, to have the element of surprise. So they knew, they must have known the situation. They must have known by that time that we were definitely going to win. So I think it was just vengeance.
I wonder if I could ask you again, just very briefly, quickly, go back to about that idea of splitting. I think because, you know, we all wear masks, metaphorically speaking, don't we, from time to time. But of course, it gets to a point where you're kind of guilty of sort of documented hypocrisy and things. You know, like saying one thing but ordering something else. One example that springs to mind. I don't know what you think about this. What do you think about this? Obviously, the famous Iron Curtain speech after the war, that an Iron Curtain has descended, you know, was it from Trieste? Anyways, that speech, of course. But isn't that an Iron Curtain that he essentially agreed to at, like, Yalta or Potsdam or one of those meetings before the war ended with Stalin?
Yes.
So he's sort of complaining about this Iron Curtain has descended across Europe, but you're massively responsible for that, Winnie.
In much the same way, he's complaining about the... Well, in much the same way, he's complaining about the behavior. Let's put it that he's complaining about the behavior of Hitler in expanding and so forth. But he's doing this because of the humiliation of Versailles. And Winnie was massively responsible for World War One and the course of World War One, including, I assume, a hand in the idea that the Germans should be utterly crushed and humiliated at Versailles, rather than a sensible policy, which would be what happened at the Congress of Vienna, which is to give the losers a reasonable peace so that they don't then get really, really pissed off and eventually start a new war. Now, what was the result of the Congress of Vienna? It was basically 100 years of peace. What was the result of the Versailles? It was 20 years of peace. So because it was a stupid thing to do. But these people were motivated by vengeance because so many people had been killed. And so many people had been killed in part because of the incompetence of people like Churchill at Gallipoli and the risks that they took and whatever with other people's lives. So, you know, I would argue that you could Churchill should shoulder some of the blame for what happened to Germany and for what happened to for the rise of Nazism. And then he's the one saying, oh, I'm going to fight it. I'm going to defeat these wicked Nazis, you know. And then they are suing for peace and they don't want a war with Britain. That's the last thing they want. But he won't have it. He wants to have his war and his glory and his, you know, cigar and all this stuff. And I think it just was an utter waste of British life. It was a waste of 7 years or 6 years, whatever it was, of my grandfather's life, which he's never going to get back. Never get back. As they took from him. And it was the waste of the, you know, the life of a good friend of mine and her father. She never met her father because the father died when she was a baby. Killed in 1940, and all the other people that were affected by this, I just think there was no reason for Britain to get involved in that war, and also Versailles itself and World War One. Its conduct was a terrible mistake, and Churchill was heavily involved in that. So yeah, there's positive sides to Churchill. We've looked at these, but I think overall he should be judged much more harshly, and even someone like his prep school headmaster, Herbert Snape Kinnersley, who was trying to basically make this appalling boy, I found the testimonies of our boys that were there at the school with him at the time. He said that his behavior was just beyond anything, that it's just unbelievable, jumping around on the table and swearing and whatever. And even then, at that point, by the way, the headmaster didn't birch him for doing that. He just threatened he would if he didn't stop. There were these terrible rumours about him once he'd left the school of what he was like. I mean, it was just the most appallingly badly behaved boy. Now, to be fair, probably part of that was the fact that he was mentally unstable and had been born prematurely, which causes autism and all kinds of things like this. So yeah, he's a product of his genetics. And he's a product of his father, as far as I can work out, was some kind of depressive as well. And so he's a product of his genetics. So in that sense, okay, it's not kind of his fault, but then in that sense, nothing's anybody's fault. But I just think that there shouldn't be such a positive appraisal of him.
It's interesting you talked about sort of genetics and you mentioned heredity, I think, earlier. So obviously he's very aristocratic, isn't he? I mean, his grandfather was a duke. He was born born in Blenheim Palace? Is that right?
Yes,
one of them. I mean, it's fantastically grand, Blenheim, isn't it? I mean, so he's sort of extremely aristocratic, right? I mean, as aristocratic as you could get without being in the royal family or up and around that. Is that fair to say?
But the highest rank of it's the highest rank of the nobility, isn't it? The Duke.
Of course, yeah. He wasn't in the direct line, was he? But
no, his father was Lord Randolph Churchill. His father was the second son of the Duke.
Right. And so, and you talked earlier on a little bit also about sort of confidence or being able to project this sort of unbelievably charismatic style of confidence. Do you think any of that sort of came with, or it's been an extremely badly behaved small child as well. Do you think any of that comes from sort of his upbringing that he was sort of raised, maybe the earliest things he was taught is that, you know, he's an aristocrat and he can do as he pleases?
Oh, no, I don't think so, because if that was the case, then all aristocrats would be like that. My experience of aristocrats is that they do have a people I've known personally, is that they have been to Eton and whatever, is that they do have a certain sort of confidence confidence that they are inherently part of the elite, and then they never have to worry about money and they never whatever. But in the same way, a lot of them are brought up with a kind of noblesse oblige, where a deliberately harsh yet stable environment is created for them. And that's what these prep schools were about and these public schools were about. It was basically transposing the ideas of Sparta onto the English upper class. Plato said, Plato was very impressed by Sparta. And of course, all of the upper class were very impressed by the classics and the classical world. And Plato said that the upper class man should never know his parents. And so you have this idea that they're separated. The idea is to break the bond with the parent so that the bond is with the nation. That they're going to leave, and to put them through this hazing, really, this kind of brutalization, such that any individuality and selfishness and whatever is sort of beaten out of them, literally beaten out of them. And they have a strong sense that they have to behave in a certain way for the good of the nation and the good of the, and so on, and dedicate themselves to the nation. And then they're taken away from where they're from. So they have, when they're at home, they're not really at home because they're only there half the year. When they're at school, they're not really at school. That's not really home. So the only sense of home is really the nation or the empire. And that's great because that's what they're going to lead. So I'm not sure that they're brought up to be spoiled. Quite the opposite. I would think that the people that are more spoiled is the sort of upper middle class that have the private. I think you see this now. The people that have been not to public schools, but to private schools. So people of my generation, they went to the public schools, they would be caned, they would, and they were put through this kind of Spartan regimen. Whereas the people that went to the private schools, that's just a very good school that you pay to go to and you go home at the end of the day. So they have all of the benefits of being rich and wealthy and not having to worry about money and all this, but none of the noblesse oblige, none of the Spartan dimension to it. So that's where you're going to get spoilt bastards among those that have been to private day schools. And I noticed that when I was at Durham University, that it was the public school people have been to Eton and whatever. I got on with them quite well. It was the people that have been to private day schools that were obnoxious.
Yes, one thing to mention is that Churchill did have a very snobbish attitude, though, didn't he? And there's no denying that, right?
Yeah, he was a snob. I mean, in that film, they portrayed him as riding on a London bus or on the Underground or something. I'm sure he never, ever did such a thing. I would imagine he would fear getting tuberculosis if he did so. So I don't think you could be absolutely certain he never did that. That was interesting, actually, doing the biography of his servant, and I found that he couldn't do things like run his own bath, he couldn't get dressed without help, he needed the butler to sort of draw back his bed clothes for him. He couldn't do these kinds of things. He always would have had servants, even at his school presumably as well, to do these kinds of things for him. So that was a definite element to him as well.
Right, okay, very interesting. I realise we're sort of getting a little short on time, I would like to ask you a couple more questions, if that's okay, if you've got
a touch more time.
Thank you. So one thing I wanted to sort of bring it up to date, the things that go on around Churchill's statue in the corner of Parliament Square there, what was it, last summer, or where they had to put a box around it to prevent people from... well, potentially ripping it down, certainly vandalising it again. And now I largely agree with your view of Churchill. I'm not a giant fan. I don't put him on a pedestal or anything historically. And yet I am sort of annoyed, a bit outraged when people vandalise the statue. And I know it's a contradiction.
And it's not. I don't think it's a contradiction. On the one hand, we have. It's like distinguishing between the Jesus of real life and the Jesus of faith. Right. So you can look in detail as far as it's possible, based on the limited sources we have, about what the actual life of Jesus was like. And you can distinguish that from the notion of Jesus and the image of Jesus transposed onto the broader notion of God or the gods, and being symbolic of your society and of its sense of its own importance and of its sense of it, something eternal and something ineffable and of the sort of mysterium tremendum et fascinans and just something greater that goes into aspects of kin and whatever and of your sort of people and seeing Jesus as symbolically wrapped up in that, and therefore, you know, you don't like pissing on people pissing on Jesus for that reason. But that is distinct from the historical Jesus, the Jesus of faith. And we have to distinguish between them. It's quite understandable. There is the Churchill, there is the historical Churchill, who is a fat, drunken, narcissistic, alcoholic, warmongering bastard. And there is the with some redeeming qualities. And it is those only that are taken out and put onto the Churchill of faith. And the Churchill of faith is a symbol of the post-World War II Britain and therefore is a symbol that becomes wrapped up with and glued into other symbols of Britishness, rightly or wrongly, Shakespeare and all of these symbolic discourses that make up the sort of... In Clifford Geertz's terms, he has this idea that religion is a set of symbols that seem somehow uniquely realistic, and it's sort of a replacement religion of which he is a part, and it's the replacement religion of a sort of traditional conservative Britain that has developed between the I don't know when it started and Victorian era, perhaps, is what we look back to that, don't we, for Christmas and everything. It all starts with the Victorian era, and he was Victorian, Churchill, so and Charles Dickens and all that, and it's wrapped up and it's part of that. So it's defacing Britain, and it's therefore for them to do that, and it's defacing. It is therefore insulting, and it is insulting. It is kind of, in the sense that our Britishness is a genetic thing, and it's our ethnic interests and whatever British ethnic group. It's wrapped up in basically defecating on us as a people, and trying to make us feel crap, and trying to make us feel that, you know, we're not worth anything, and we're useless, and we should just kill ourselves. And that's what it's trying to do. And that's why it's perfectly natural to concomitantly be critical of Churchill and be feel a sense of disgust at what they do, because what that is doing is defecating on the sacred, defecating on the Holy of Holies, and that is totally social organization has to have a religion and has to have things that are holy, and their things that are holy are things like black people and transsexuals men can have cocks and whatever, and our things that are holy are a religion, the religious Christianity of a certain kind, and in certain things that are wrapped up in that, such as the literature, Dickens, Shakespeare, and people like Churchill, because he won a war. And so I don't see it as a contradiction. It is a contradiction, but it's an understandable contradiction.
All right. Oh, yeah. I mean, so on that note then, the idea of how Churchill's memory is used, perhaps in the popular consciousness. So what I'm trying to say is that, as you say, the actual real man himself was highly flawed, should we say. Mm-hmm. And yet he serves a purpose for many, which is positive, isn't it?
Exactly. That's what Claude Levi-Strauss said about myth, that myth should be understood in a functional way. Myth should be understood as something which holds the society together. It doesn't matter if it's true. It's almost certainly not true. The point is that it holds the society together. Churchill himself says that the truth has to be protected by a wall of lies. It's something like that. It doesn't matter if it's true. In fact, if anything, you can guarantee it won't be true. But it holds the society together. What you have with the political correctness is an attempt at a new religion. And you hold society together around a religion of anti-racism the other aspects of woke. And it's based around complete empirical lies. Oh, yeah, we're all equal and all this. But it holds society together. And what you have with, what do you want to call it? Academic agent, I don't know if you've heard of him, he calls it the boomer truth regime. And the boomer truth regime, in which Churchill is this important figure, kind of held together the post-war British people, that we are united because we went through the war together and it was Churchill that was our captain during that war. And that was a big part of dealing with all of the conflicts that there were post-war, trade unions versus the traditional businesses and whatever else, were held together by this mythology, this golden, glorious past of the Blitz spirit and all this, to which Churchill was so central. So it was a fundamental mutation, I guess you could say, in the ersatz religion of Britishness, to which Churchill was central. And that's why it's so important. I mean, that's why I've done so many videos about him, you know, to the extent that I invested in a Homburg. You know, I mean, it's why you have to have your Churchill stuff.
You just need a Tommy gun with a drum magazine on it now.
I've got the cigar somewhere. Where did I put my cigar? Oh yeah, I haven't smoked this. I found it in the pocket of my tuxedo, and I think I must have got this in about 2002 for a formal in Durham, and I haven't smoked it, and so I just use it for.
Will it still be smokable? Do they keep?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. As long as it's kept in a tin like this, then as long as it's kept moist.
Okay,
I believe it's all right.
Well, excellent. Well, one last thing, just to sort of finish it off on what you've said there. Do you think that is that sort of valuable, sort of undeniably, I think, valuable take on Churchill that you've described there? Is it best to slay that? Or is it best to sort of leave it in place? I mean, do you sort of understand what I'm asking there?
Yes, I understand what you're asking, but maybe we should say that the boomer truth regime, if you want to call it, is wrong and
it's just liars,
slain.
Right, and needs to be destroyed.
That we shouldn't have gone to war with Germany. Right. This is propping up some false view of history. And it's propping up other things that we're beating ourselves up over as Europeans. We're beating ourselves up over World War II over what happened in it. I can see arguments for completely displacing it. I think one should maintain a careful balance. I think, but the left want to commandeer Churchill as well. Though they want to try and say, oh, he was fighting against the Nazis, he was fighting against fascism, he was fighting against racism, and he absolutely wasn't. He was by any standards a racist. Not only was he a racist, he was a committed eugenicist before the Second World War that seriously wanted to look into having eugenics policies in Britain, and he was quite clear that, you know, we need to limit the fertility of the working classes, or we're going to be in serious trouble. He was very, very clear about that, and what he had to say about Islam hasn't exactly aged well either. if you read what he had to say about Islam,
some of the things he says about the Sudanese in the River War are kind of comically unbelievable.
Yeah, but personally, from my perspective, I'm interested as a researcher. I'm just interested in getting the truth.
Right. Sure.
And the moment somebody says to me, "Oh, don't look at that," or the moment somebody uses fallacious arguments. So, like when I was talking about this Churchill stuff, someone accused me of being the Churchill pub bore. I was thinking, okay, the fact that you have to use that insulting language means that I'm onto something, and you don't like it. It's triggered you. It's triggered your cognitive dissonance. It's triggered the distinction between what you'd like to be the case and what is the case. And so you have to use this insulting language like pub bore or whatever to dismiss it. But that shows me I'm onto something, and that shows me I'll do it more. because that's where the truth lies. And whatever it is, if it's dismissed as pseudoscience or pseudo-history or whatever, you know you're onto something. And so that's why I became fascinated, as I say, not so much by Churchill, actually, but by Herbert Snake Kinnersley, because I realised that if all of this stuff we were told about Churchill being brilliant was wrong, then maybe what we're told about Herbert Snake Kinnersley being just the epitome of evil was also wrong, or at least was lacking in nuance. And so that's what really got me fascinated by, you know, Herbert Snake Kinnersley to the extent of writing Churchill's Headmaster.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Like, sunlight is the best disinfectant, for want of a better cliche. Yeah, no, well, okay, Professor Dutton, if we draw it to a close there, I really appreciate your time. I know it's limited. It's been...
Well, if you have any other questions, then fire away.
Oh, well, I mean, Well, I suppose one of the sort of larger questions I would like to run by you was you've talked a lot about or a bit about the rise and fall of civilizations, that sort of idea, the sweep of history and things, and that it's difficult to argue against the idea that we're in a downward trend at the moment. You agree with that. I wondered if you thought... Again, it's maybe a bit too broad of a question, but how low it might go. I'm asking you to sort of predict the future, but how much of a precipitous dip are we looking at?
Yeah, here? I've got a book coming out on this in July. It's called The Past is a Future Country, The Coming Conservative Demographic Revolution. And based on current data, the IQ of Britain and other Western countries will be about 85 by the end of the century. So 15 points lower than it is now. We currently have, based on various proxies, about the same IQ that we would have had in about 1600, having reached a peak in about 1800 or somewhere like that, based on per capita major innovation rates. The 85 IQ is the same as the average IQ of, let's say, a low-level security guard, something like that. And so that will be the highest of IQs, well, with the exception of certain countries will be a bit higher, like Northeast Asia, but they're also in decline. So they might have an IQ by then of 90. And so this means that all the countries that have lower IQs than the Western countries will be in serious trouble because they won't be propped up anymore by high IQ countries. 85 seems to be about the IQ that we had in about 1100, based on major per capita innovation. So at the end of the last dark age. And from which we rose up. So it's dark age level IQ. It's the collapse level IQ. But what could happen is because, so what we would expect to happen is there'll be a gradual collapse, policies will break up, more intelligent people will split away from the growing chaos and form sort of neo-Byzantiums, we call them in the book. You know, Rome never completely died. It held on. Civilization, to the heights that it got, held on in Byzantium for a very long time, right? And then, and also to a lesser extent in the Islamic world. That was invaded by the Muslims, and then the Byzantines came back to the West, and then you have the Renaissance, and then zoom, up we go. We start going up. Partly because as well it got colder, and that strongly selected for intelligence as well. And so that was another factor. And very cold, more than minimum, very high IQ, industrial revolution, breakthrough, whatever. But basically, civilization is a pyramid scheme. What always happens is that if you have harsh conditions, people get very, very intelligent, and you select for intelligence, and you get civilization, you bring in civilization, limits Darwinian conditions. It makes it easier. So therefore, selection pressures become weaker, and therefore people become stupider. And also, for some reason, intelligent people stop wanting to have children. It's something to do with them being environmentally sensitive and religion not hitting in because we're evolved to be in mortality salience, but we're not in it. And so therefore we just stop having children, and intelligent people are less instinctive and are less impulsive. So they don't have children by accident. So the only people that have children are those that have them by accident, and they're stupid people. And so intelligence goes down and society collapses. And the more you extend it by, The bigger they are, the harder they fall. So what we're in now is a massively extended Malthusian rise. And what happens when you get civilization is you reduce selection in terms of intelligence, but also in terms of genetic health and things like that. So people become very genetically sick. And then eventually you get something like a plague, like the Great Justinian Plague. And that was 60% of people died in a very short period of time. So it's a massive collapse. And then you have a dark age of 1,000 years or so. And then you have another, and then it happens all over again. But what you have in our situation is we've risen so high that by the time we're too stupid to be able to operate at all the various machines and so forth that we have made, we could have a much lower IQ than 85. It could be that we 70 or something. And we'd also be very, very genetically sick indeed. And therefore, when the collapse happened, which it would, for some reason, you know, it got colder, let's say, or there was a asteroid strike or a solar flare or something, the devastation would be absolute. I mean, in 1859, there was what's called a Carrington event, which is a significant solar flare. It knocked out the electricity system at the time, The telegraph machines caught fire, and the electricity was completely knocked out. But that wasn't that bad because hardly any people had electricity. But now that we've got, now our infrastructure is completely reliant on electricity and on all this complex stuff. So when that's knocked out, we won't. We'll be very stupid. We'll be very genetically sick. Everyone reliant on the health service and whatever, and nobody will have passed on useful things like gardening or how to hunt or whatever. So you'll just get mass death, like 99% death. So that's and then if you have a long period of ice age or something, there'll be no evidence of us left. There'll be hardly any of us left. There'll be hardly any evidence of us left at all. So that's a possibility. That's the pessimistic possibility. The optimistic one, as I said, is more like a kind of classical collapse.
One thing you say, where like sort of out, the IQ would go down to 85 or 70 or whatever you say. You mean like that's an average day, because it's a bell curve. So if you've got millions of people, there will always be some high IQ.
Yeah, average. But then the high IQ people, the people that are the outliers, will just have a lower IQ than the people that would be the outliers if the average was 100.
The mini Byzantium thing is fascinating. So you're sort of, it's maybe sort of small enclaves of high IQ people that have ganged together for survival.
Yes.
That sort of thing. That's fascinating, because I've had a similar idea, just sort of an imagination of the near future, or in a few decades' time, that all the cities are completely overtaken, and there's just small enclaves of native Brits rurally, small islands of them.
That's what I think would happen. I don't know if it would be Britain. I mean, Britain might completely go. But I would suspect that there will be parts of Eastern Europe, for example, that will hold out, and you'll have the more intelligent white people and the more intelligent people of other races as well that will like white align and breed into the white population. And that's where it will be. There will be various areas that will be these Byzantiums, and then there'll just be chaos, hell. The third world will just get bigger, basically, much, much bigger, and the first world smaller.
The thing where you say it could be a collapse, sort of a systems-wide collapse, where maybe 99% casualties and things like this. I don't know if you have in mind, you know, sort of perhaps the collapse of the classical Roman Empire.
That would be the good thing. The classical Roman Empire collapse, that's definitely going to happen. That would involve the near Byzantiums and things like that. What I'm saying would be a collapse that would be considerably worse than that.
Right. That's interesting. Do you not think that there's some things, some advances of modernity that would prevent something that catastrophic? I don't know, if as long as you've got a few high IQ people left. I don't know, it just seems like
if the average IQ was, I don't know about that, but if the average IQ was 85, then the outliers, so that's people with an IQ of above 130, would be a minuscule number.
All right.
If any.
All right. Wow. I mean, it's a lot. I look forward to the book. What was it called again? I remember it's a very interesting title.
It was called "The Past Is a Future Country: The Coming Conservative Demographic Revolution," and it's written, co-authored with JOA Rayner Hills, and it's coming out with Imprint Academic in July.
Oh well, excellent stuff.
Would you like me to come back on and talk about that when that comes along?
That would be excellent if you would. Yeah,
let's do that. I'd love to do that. Would be great.
Oh well, thanks, Ed. I really appreciate that. I definitely would be an honour and a pleasure to have you back.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, great. Thanks a lot, then.
All right, then. Take care. Bye bye.